Dr. Bill Amonette is the director of the Health and Human Performance Institute at the University of Houston Clear Lake. He has served as an exercise physiologist and strength and conditioning specialist to the astronauts at NASA, a strength and conditioning coach for the Houston Rockets, the Chinese Olympic basketball team, and a whole lot of other accolades that we just don't have time to go over in this episode. Welcome to the podcast, Doc.
Thank you. Glad to be here. Thank you for the invitation.
Yeah. So, Bill, we've known you for actually over 20 years now that I kind of went back and thought about it. And yeah. we actually give a lot of credit to our mutual friend, Chris Miner, for introducing us to you and to the barbell back in the early 2000s for us. And before we recorded this, I asked Chris for any embarrassing stories that I could bring up in this interview.
Oh, God. He's got a few.
He said that I should ask you about a time that you guys were bench pressing at the Y. And apparently Chris kind of demonstrating his lack of knowledge of how to spot the bench press. Do you remember this story?
Yeah. So I actually share this story every semester in my resistance exercise class that I teach. We were doing a bench press without collars on the barbell. And so I'm pressing it. I've got somebody behind me who's spotting me appropriately. And I start to, Chris thought I was struggling a little bit. I wasn't struggling. And he runs over and he grabs one end of the barbell and he lifts it up. And so all the weights dump off of one side. And then of course, all the weights dump off the other side. And of course, he's ran out of the room at this point. And so I'm standing there in the YMCA, having made this incredibly loud noise, holding a barbell with no weight over me, with all the weights laying on the ground. And so, you know, in textbooks, they always say, they show spotting, and they showed, you know, two people spotting on each side of the barbell. And because of that story, I tell my students that the books are wrong. They either spot with one spotter or three spotters, because you never want one person on one side of the barbell who, you know, jumps the gun and lifts it. And there you are standing with an empty barbell in the YMCA.
I think the other most common spotting error I see, and it really makes people mad, is when they're going for kind of maybe a PR or just a really heavy rep. And, you know, they're grinding on it, the bar still going up, and in comes the spotter and touches the bar before the lifter actually fails.
Nothing worse than that.
Isn't that sad? Blakely's an amazing spotter. She will let me grind on a rep for like 10 seconds before she jumps in.
Good.
Oh, man. Well, you know, your journey from high school football player to professor to the director of an important institute has a common thread that runs through it, and that's the barbell and barbell training. How did you get started in barbell training, and what impact has it had on your life and kind of your career trajectory?
Sure. So that's, you know, kind of a cool story. In the sixth grade, my dad, for Christmas, bought me an old Joe Weider weightlifting set. And so it was, you know, you filled them full of sand, right? You bought these plastic weights, you filled them full of sand, and you put them in a small barbell. And so we set something up in the garage back then, and I started to learn how to lift weights. My dad never lifted weights, so he just kind of taught me what he had seen before. But pretty quickly, I kind of outgrew the Joe Weider set and needed something else. And my dad had a friend who was kind of a bodybuilder. He was a carpenter by trade. His name was Keith Bowden. And he was joining the YMCA. My dad heard about it, and he asked Keith if I could join the YMCA and he could, you know, teach me some things about resistance training. And so I joined the YMCA, and Keith kind of becomes, you know, my first mentor as a sixth grader. And so we would go to the YMCA. Keith was so cool. Like, I still think back about that. He, you know, he drove a motorcycle. So, you know, we'd go to the Y on the motorcycle, or we'd go in his work van and we'd be blasting Guns N' Roses or something on the way there. And, you know, just kind of fell in love with weightlifting at that point. Weightlifting, two words at that point. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it just kind of grew. Like, you know, I always played sports, always played football, but I probably enjoyed preparation more so than the game. I love the weight room. Like, I would stay in the weight room, you know, after practice until they kicked me out. And then I would go and eat dinner, and then I would go to the YMCA and stay until 9 o'clock at night, violating everything that I teach about how one ought to program and resistance exercise. But, you know, it just, I just loved it and really enjoyed it. And so, and as far as a career, I started out at Stephen F. Austin State University, and I was going to be a coach and a teacher. And I was there for about a year and a half, and then I transferred to, and I had another guy that kind of influenced me there. His name was Kevin Likens. He was our strength and conditioning coach, and I never knew that you could do that and, you know, get paid for it and call it a career. And so, you know, Kevin was instrumental in kind of motivating me that direction. But I transferred to a school called Harding in Searcy, Arkansas, and I was going to be a preacher. And I did that for one semester and decided that, you know, God might call me to preaching, but he wasn't calling me to Arkansas. And so I came back home to Texas, and I was a psychology major for a semester, and I was just kind of all over the place. And, you know, one of my uncles told me, he said, you know, if you're going to go into ministry, you know, God will use you. You don't have to get a degree in it. Just get a degree in something that you love. And I kind of thought about what I loved, and, you know, I thought about Kevin Likens and his job. And so I'm kind of looking for an opportunity, you know, academically, where I'm going to go next. And I'm literally lost. So I grew up in this area in Pasadena. If anybody's ever seen Urban Cowboy, you know what that is. Pasadena, Texas, not California. And
important distinction.
I'm lost. And I see the University of Houston, Clear Lake. And I never heard of it, right? Grew up in this area, never heard of UH Clear Lake. And so I walk in the door and, you know, I find a degree called Fitness and Human Performance. And Dr. Coleman, Gene Coleman, was there at the time. And I walk into his office and meet the guy that really would pave the course of my career, the rest of my career, still to this day. Get a degree here from UH Clear Lake. I still thought that I was going to be a physical therapist or something like that. Not really, you know, honing in on strength and conditioning yet. I did that for about a year. I worked in a PT clinic and decided that, you know, I wanted to be a strength coach. You know, I loved weightlifting. I loved the weight room. I loved, at that point, Olympic weightlifting. And so I got a job working at NASA while I was finishing my bachelor's degree, and I was a trainer on a study where we were looking at the first resistance exercise device that was on the International Space Station. It was called the IRED. And so we did the original research on that. And, you know, that was kind of my first introduction into science. But, you know, that whole time I just kept thinking back, I want to be Kevin Likens. I want to be Gene Coleman, you know, and Gene was a professor here and the strength coach for the Astros. And so I end up interning at the Olympic Training Center in Chula Vista, California. And it was the coolest experience ever. I'm just so many, we could have a whole show talking about some of the athletic feats that I saw from some of the people there. But I finish, applying for jobs, and I got interviews for two jobs and offers for two jobs. One was at Ohio State as an assistant strength coach. They were going to pay $18,000 a year with a master's degree. And I couldn't pay back my student loans with that. And then the other one was at North Dakota State University, which would pay twice as much. But the day that I interviewed there, it was like negative 20. And I'm from Houston, so there was no way. And so I ended up coming back home and, you know, getting a job working back at NASA in kind of a science integration role, where I would, you know, if there was a study funded by NASA anywhere in the world, my job was to go in and train staff on kind of the dependent measures that we measured in space flight before and after. Three or four of them were exercise-based, strength-based tests, and the rest were, you know, other physiologic tests. But while I'm doing that, this is actually a really good part of the story. Chris and I are members at 24 Hour Fitness, and he can tell you this story. And so 24 Hour Fitness over in Pasadena, and I was a member there because they were the only place in town that had a weightlifting platform and an Olympic barbell. And so this is 2002. And so they have an Olympic, they have an Olico barbell, they have rubber weights, they have a weightlifting platform. And so I'm, you know, practicing Olympic lifts. And so one day I'm working on the snatch, and whoever was their head trainer comes up and says, you know, I'm just going to tell you this one time, don't drop weights in my weight room. And I said, I'm going to just tell you this one time that those are rubber weights. That's a weightlifting platform and an Olico barbell. That's what it's for. And he said, well, you know, do it again and see what happens. And so I wanted to see what happened. So I snatched it and dropped it back on the platform. And I end up banned from 24 Hour Fitness. So I'm kicked out of 24 Hour Fitness for Olympic weightlifting. And
on their Olympic weightlifting platform.
Yeah. So I started Garage Gym back before garage gyms were cool in 2002. And Tim Swords helped me to get some rubber weights and some weightlifting bars and start training some kids. And then eventually, you know, some guys that ended up playing professional baseball. And at one point, the number one pole vaulter in the world was training in my garage to LaPorte. And so it just kind of grew to, you know, eventually moved into a role as a strength coach for astronauts. So implementing, you know, but while they're on Earth and then also while they're on the space station, their exercise programs. And, you know, kind of in that interim, like I end up with all these cool opportunities working with first with Othella Harrington, who was a basketball player here in Houston. And then another NBA guy, and then personal trainer for Patrick Ewing, and kind of all this morphs until eventually, you know, I'm offered a job with the Rockets, and which was a lot of fun, but it just, you know, wouldn't have been possible to have a family kind of in that position, at least the way I wanted to have a family. So ended up, you know, going back to school and getting a PhD in rehabilitation sciences. With the focus in you know, endocrinology, looking at growth hormone and how it responds to exercise in people with traumatic brain injury. And, you know, all that kind of leads to where I am today, leading this institute here at the university that I accidentally found, you know, which, back in 1997. Blakely,
that's both of our alma mater, actually. Blakely and I both graduated from that college, too.
Yeah, and we've grown a lot, man. You've got to come back and I'll give you a tour of the campus. We've doubled in size, in physical size with our buildings and everything. But yeah, so kind of the common thread through all of that is, you know, is like, as you said, the barbell.
Yeah.
You know, like I tell my students that, you know, my job is to teach you how to operate a barbell. And, you know, and there's so much complexity to that, but there's also so much simplicity. Which is what I really love about it, that, you know, there's all this science and biology behind programming. But at the end of the day, we've got to give it to the consumer in a way that it makes sense, that they believe in it, and that they'll commit to it. And, you know, that's kind of what my job is, to teach them first the complexity of it, but then to teach the simplicity of coaching and how to, you know, be a good communicator of weightlifting.
I think that's one of your strengths is because of your background, you went, you kind of started with an application based situation, and then you went into a research based situation, back to an application based situation, then to an educational situation. So you're in a unique opportunity to understand the science, have done, you know, dozens of research projects and been a part of, you know, huge research projects, but then as a professor and as somebody who's working in a lab, applying this stuff to real people, you know how to kind of bring it down to the level where it's something that somebody can apply to their own life, which without that, what is the point?
Absolutely. And that's, you know, what I tell some of my students is, you know, the challenge sometime is, you know, especially when we're starting out in our career, we want to, you know, convince everybody how smart we are by telling them everything that we know in our first conversation. And really what they need to know is keep your whole foot on the ground when you're squatting. And it's that simple, right?
Right.
And
so we change the outcome.
Yeah. So we, you know, we always say we look for the simplest solution, always look for the simplest solution.
And I love that.
Yeah. So that's kind of our mantra in coaching is to, you know, break it down into its smallest parts, into its simplest parts, and only give people what they need.
Yeah.
You know, only give them what they need, and the rest of it, you know, certainly it helps inform our coaching, but it's not necessary to communicate that to get somebody right. to lift weights correctly.
Yeah. Yeah, that's so true. And, you know, my mind is racing with a million different ways we can take this conversation. That's probably going to need to be divided up into like 10 episodes sure. having you back on. But I thought today we could kind of hone in on something that I know you're really passionate about. And it's probably one of the main missions at the Institute, unless I'm wrong, but it's taking advantage of the benefits of proper training and nutrition as we age to improve our life in our later years, instead of just kind of drifting off into chronic disease and weakness and dependence on others. How big of a problem is this in our aging population here in America? And like, and why is that so important to you?
Yeah. So it's a tremendous problem right now, and it's worse than it was 10 years ago. And 10 years from now, it's going to be really bad. And, you know, it's because of what we've all been talking about for many years, this kind of the wave of the baby boomers that are, you know, moving into their retirement years. And certainly that has an economic impact on society, but also has a public health impact and a personal health impact, in that as we age, we, you know, we have more chronic disease. We tend to lose our independence. We become reliant on both, you know, the medical system and then on others, you know, to take care of us. And we have this wave, you know, of people that are moving into that category. And, you know, unfortunately, the thing that we're not talking about enough is, you know, how can we take control of that through exercise and nutrition? I don't think the data suggests that exercise helps you live longer. But what the data does suggest is that exercise and nutrition help us to live more quality years of life. And that's one of the things that we talk about, this, you know, epidemiologic concept of compressing the morbidity curve to where we move the onset of sickness closer and closer to the onset of death, mm-hmm. right? Because, you know, we all want to go out, you know, not where we're spending the last 5 or 10 years, you know, of our life on medicine or in an assisted living facility where we can't take care of ourselves, but, you know, to be as well as we can all the way up until the end. And you know, for, you know, and that's kind of what, you know, one of our main missions is here, is to help people maintain their function and to deal with, to do that through all the challenges that we have as we age. You know, it's, you know, osteoarthritis and, you know, osteoporosis and all the different things that we see that can be managed through exercise, but to help them train functionally, you know, while not either making those conditions worse or to learn how to adapt or modify exercise to where they can continue to do things that'll help them be most healthy.
Yeah, I think kind of to sum up that general idea is, like, you know, we're living longer as a people for a lot of different reasons, you know, modern medicine and medication and things like that. But what is really the point of a longer lifespan if the quality of life isn't there? And that quality of life thing is the thing that we have the most control over. And as I want to talk about a little bit later, but, you know, so much of that, what happens to you in your 60s and in 70s is being set up by what you do in your 30s and 40s.
Yeah.
I think you would probably agree with that, but I think there's this problem. There's this 5-letter word that is persistent that holds everybody back from taking action on that. And it's the word later. Like, we feel like, okay, you know, I don't feel that bad now. I'm not that sick now. I'll get to it later. Yeah. And I think a lot of people, and I'm guilty of this too, you know, you're in decent shape in your college years, and maybe you were in high school, you were fit. In college, you were relatively healthy. And then slowly in your 30s, you start gaining weight, you lose any strength that you have, and you just decide, you know, I'm going to put it off and get to it later. Do you find this with people that you see in practice?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, that's, you know, an interesting concept, you know, what you're talking about, and incredibly important. Most people, unfortunately, like you said, they wait until there's disability to start really trying to do something about it. And, you know, we talk a lot about the concept of creating reserves here in the Institute. And, you know, I always like to use the analogy of retirement. You know, I'll ask my students, you know, what's the best way to ensure that you don't go broke in retirement? And, you know, they'll, you know, give me all these complex answers. And my answer is, well, you just have a whole lot of money in the bank when you retire, because we know we're going to start losing it, right? We're not gaining it anymore. And so the more money we have, the less likely we are to go broke. And kind of the same concept with fitness. And, you know, you can put whatever you want to in that category: strength, power, aerobic endurance, whatever it is. The best way to ensure that we don't hit a critical level of loss to where we can't function is that whenever we start to see that decline, that we have as much of that physical quality as we can, so that as it declines, we're far away from that critical level of loss. And really, you know, the same thing in retirement, right? We don't just suddenly, you know, unless we win the lottery, we're not all of a sudden going to end up with a lot of money in our bank. It takes, you know, discipline and strategy of, you know, investing and setting aside, you know, for many, many years. And the earlier that we start, you know, the more wealth we have when we retire. And the same is true of training. The earlier we start, the more committed we stay to it, you know, throughout our 30s and 40s and 50s. When we get into our 60s and we really start seeing loss, we have so much muscle already and so much strength and so much power. We're unlikely to lose so much that we can't get out of our chair anymore, or walk upstairs, or, you know, all of the other, or pick up our grandkids, whatever it is that's important for you in your life. You're more likely to be able to continue to do that if you have a reserve when you start seeing that loss.
Yeah. Sometimes, even though, you know, Blakely and I started working with a barbell 20 years ago, we didn't really understand training and do it properly, probably till the last 12, 13 years, really. So I was already in my 30s at that point. So I was basically starting from almost scratch at 30. And I use that fact to encourage our clients that, you know, they're in their 20s or they're in their 30s and they're just starting out. It's like, it's not too late. Like, no. You know, and we have clients in their 50s and 60s who, you know, they are further towards having a low reserve, but they're still working to build it back up. So I want to encourage people to know that, you know, if you're still in your 30s and 40s, you have plenty of time. If you're in your 50s and 60s now, it's still important that you start doing the things that we're going to talk about to build up your reserves and even kind of reverse some of the neglect that you've built up over the years. And it's kind of interesting because a lot of people talk about treating exercise as like a minimum effective dose kind of thing. And I get that perspective, but really what you're talking about is being aggressive when you can be aggressive, so that when you can no longer, you know, maintain the amount of volume and intensity that you could later, at least you took advantage of the time that you were able to.
Yeah. And, you know, I think it makes, when we get into our 60s and 70s, we have more opportunity. You know, we have movement literacy. We know how to do exercises. We're not kind of going through the things that we are very early in our life. And it makes it a whole lot easier as we're older to apply intensity and velocity and some things that, you know, maybe we can talk about today that are important in aging. But yeah, I would, you know, back up to what you just said about, you know, encouraging people that it doesn't matter where you're at right now, you need to start. And we have people that, you know, we've worked with here in the Institute that 82 years old walk in the door, have never exercised in their life. And, you know, the research shows in those individuals, they can double their strength, right? You're starting so low, right? You can double your strength. And so it's never too late to start. It's just better to have started when you were younger. And, you know, I think the old proverb, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago, and the second best time is right now.
Yeah.
Is so true that, you know, no matter where you're at today, just do it, get started, right? Stop thinking about it. Stop, you know, making plans and buying shoes and all that, and just get in there and get started right now where you're at.
It reminds me of the comedian Nate Bargatze's bit where his wife catches him drinking chocolate milk, and she's like, "What are you doing drinking chocolate milk?" So I read that drinking chocolate milk is important, you know, for when you're gonna start, when you work out. She's like, "Well, you don't work out." I was like, "Well, I'm getting ready. You know, I'm getting all the things. This is just part of it."
Yeah.
Let's talk real quick about what the average person thinks is the right way to exercise. Cause I think if you stopped 100 people on the street and you say, like, all right, you know, somebody's in their 30s, 40s, 50s, even their 60s and beyond, you know, they should probably just kind of, you know, take it easy, you know, do some walking, maybe some light weights, a whole bunch of reps. You know, if we take this advice, where does that get us?
Well, you know, I think, you know, at the very beginning, if you've never done anything before, we always say you change your socks and you get stronger. off the beginning. But long-term that strategy is not viable. And, you know, eventually you get to the point where you stop seeing gains and you might even start seeing losses. You know, 3 sets of 10, right? If I walk out into our facility right now and I ask the average student, what are you doing today? Or the community member who's not a part of our institute, the answer is 3 sets of 10, right? And with the same weight that you've been doing for the last 25 years. And you know, for that person, certainly they're gaining something from being in the gym, but they're really missing the opportunity to make substantial gains in their fitness, in their strength and power by using other methodologies and variation and some things that are more important. You know, the people that are doing 3 sets of 20 or, you know, 25 because they're afraid they're going to get big, right? We always hear that. You know, there's just a complete misconception about what is really effective and what really is going to make us stronger. We're not going to get stronger from 3 sets of 20, mm-hmm. right? And we're not going to get bigger from it either. We might gain some muscle endurance, but that's even questionable. And so I think we kind of get to the point where, you know, we've got to ask the question, you know, what can I do long term to really get to my goal? And if my goal is function, it's not 3 sets of 10 for the rest of your life. It's not just walking a little bit. It's, you know, learning to lift and tolerate heavier weights, and eventually, you know, learning how to move weights with some velocity and improve our power.
You're kind of hinting at what it actually takes to build strength and what, yeah. you know, and around the topic of progressive overload. Why don't you tell everybody, since you basically said doing 3 sets of 10 with the same weight for the last 20 years doesn't work, what does work?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's really pretty simple, right? Lifting heavier weights makes you stronger. Lifting lighter weights, nowhere close to failure, is just a waste of time, right? Lifting kind of in the middle at higher volumes is at high moderate intensity improves muscular size, especially when you're younger. And, you know, lifting weights with high intentional velocity improves our power. And there is an emerging body of evidence over the last 20 years that talks about lifting at 30 and 40 and 50% of our 1 RM, but lifting as fast as we can, and how that improves our power more so than lifting a heavy weight, and that, you know, is going to move slow inherently because of the weight. And the research is beginning to show or strongly support that higher velocity training in improving function. So as we talked about earlier, our ability to rise from a chair, if we fall down, the ability to get back up, the ability to walk upstairs, all those are improved by power. And I really believe that for many, many years, we talked about these five principles of health related physical fitness. And I'm going to try to remember back to 1995 what they were, but we talked about aerobic endurance and muscle strength and body composition and flexibility as the health related components. And then we said, well, athletes, they need power and speed and agility and all those things. And I believe that for health, that power might be the most important factor. Having the ability to exert force rapidly might be the biggest indicator of physical function as we age.
That's interesting. Yeah, I think that's overlooked, and it's not something we talk to our clients a lot about, but it makes sense. Is it reasonable to think, like, focusing on power as we get older is maybe a safer way to make progress also, because it doesn't require us to lift as heavy a loads? Like, we're not going to be, try to max out our clean and jerk at 65 years old, but we can still, perform explosive movement with a lighter weight and see benefit like you're talking about.
Yeah. So but I would say that, heavy resistance training is not dangerous as we age either.
True.
If we know how to do it correctly, right? I mean, it's never the weight's fault, right? It's always the operator, the weight, making a mistake and getting out of position. If we do it correctly, then we're not going to be, or unlikely to be, injured while lifting weights. One thing to say is that we have to be strong first, right? So strength is the foundation of power. I always tell my students that, if I die in the middle of this class right now, and I'll tell you on this podcast, if I go down right now, okay, you make sure that somebody puts this on my headstone. There are no weak, powerful people, right? Strength comes first. You are strong and powerful. You're never weak and powerful. And so we have to develop a base of strength first, but then there's diminishing returns to that, right? Eventually we're strong enough. And then at that point, we start to focus our training more towards, velocity-based training. But, I think maybe the listeners out there, as they're hearing this maybe for the first time, are thinking that, like you said, right, a 1RM power clean will, if we've got somebody who's 80, a high power movement might be, standing up from the chair as fast as they can.
Yeah.
Right. True. That might be, 30, 40, 50% of their 1RM, or putting a light vest on, weighted vest on, and doing those movements, or, on a leg press where they're in a little bit more controlled environment because maybe they don't have the movement literacy to perform a squat at high velocity, lifting at a lower percentage, but doing that at a faster rate.
Yeah.
So that's kind of what we're talking about. But, Mike Stone, who is, one of the founders of strength and conditioning in America, says that strength is the tide that makes all boat rise. And so strength is kind of the foundation of everything. But once we have that strength, we begin to focus on some other things that can be important for our health.
Yeah, that's a good saying. I may steal that.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I think maybe some people haven't ever even thought about what power is. Can you give us a definition of what power even means?
Yeah, so I think very simply, it's the ability to rapidly express strength. To be able to generate force fast. And, that could be at, heavier loads or at lighter loads. Obviously we normally think of a vertical jump as a really good test of power. But we actually measure power here in the Institute with, force plates, having people do sit to stand movements and just having them do that as fast as they can. And that, of course, relies on, those type 2X muscle fibers and kind of a different coordination scenario in the central nervous system to rapidly express strength. And it's something that as we age, we tend to lose because we start to lose some of those type 2X muscle fibers. Some of that is natural with aging. You know, sarcopenia is kind of the gradual loss of skeletal muscle mass that happens as we age. And some of that is those type 2X fibers. But if you think about, again, back to what we were talking about earlier, the way we typically train as we age, we're not recruiting those type 2X fibers. And so that probably has a more profound effect on their loss than, you know, just the natural process of aging.
And I think this is something we talk about a lot in our content, and maybe somebody listening to this is like, but I exercise, you know, I'm probably good. But, you know, one of our missions with this company is, you know, the long-term vision of, you know, helping people stave off chronic disease and get healthy, but yeah, to create awareness about that, that not all exercise is created equal, and you could spend the valuable time that you have and don't have a lot of doing a lot of things that will never lead you to the great outcomes that we're talking about. I'm talking specifically about just doing things like running, biking, spinning, lifting those light weights. And I think this ties in with what you're saying, that, you know, not all exercise is training, and not all exercise will help you, you know, stave off weakness and independence or dependence as you age.
Yeah. That, you know, one thing I like to say is there are a lot of things that work. I'm looking for what works best. And that's really, you know, what I want to advise people on what to do. And, you know, I don't want to say, by the way, that I've got it all figured out, because, you know, I can't tell you how many times, you know, over, you know, 20 years of my career that my opinion on what works best has been shifted, you know, because of an evolving body of scientific literature. But I think that's what we're all after, right? I mean, if we're going to go spend an hour in the weight room, make that the most productive hour of training that we can have, and, you know, fill that time full of things that are truly helpful and impactful versus just spending an hour at the gym doing something.
Right.
Right. And unfortunately, I think that's what a lot of us end up doing is, you know, we say, well, I went to the gym for an hour today, right? But your hour of being at the gym might have been completely different than another person's hour at the gym, depending on what they did with that hour.
Yeah. And how they did it.
Yeah.
I think this leads perfectly into the next thing I want to talk about. Let's say that you're conducting a research study with an unlimited budget, and you get to test what you think is the best way to train somebody for longevity. Let's say they're in their 40s, like we are. What do you have your study participants doing in that study?
Well, how long is the study?
you get to set all the parameters. Let's say you had, you know, somewhere between a year and 7 years.
Yeah, so it varies, right? And it varies very much like it would a periodization model for an athlete. And, you know, I think that's something that's missed, is that we think athletes should train differently than the rest of us. But the reality is, when we're looking at our programming, right, depending on your training age, you know, there's a general preparation phase at the beginning where we're developing a conditioning base and getting accustomed to exercise. And there's a hypertrophy base where during that time, we're not only developing muscle size, but more importantly, strength of connective tissues, and then a shift towards strength, and then a shift towards power. And that is always involved in a program for anybody. I work with one of my colleagues, Dr. John Cottingham, who's an MD here in this area. He says that human beings are a species of athletes, right? And I truly believe that we were meant to be athletic. And so, you know, that's what we're doing, right? In this study, is we've got a periodized model that's changing over time, that's morphing as we gain a good conditioning base and a good strength base, to eventually to where we look at the back end of that program 7 or 10 years down the line, and we have, you know, we have more velocity based training, we have, you know, higher intensities because we've developed a tolerance to that. So mm-hmm. And then I guess the control group is doing what everybody else does, and that's three sets of 10.
Well, really, if we're talking about the average American, I think I heard a statistic that only 15% of the American population even has a gym membership. And I think we know because of the fact that places like, you know, Planet Fitness and 24 Hour Fitness, they kind of thrive on the fact that people sign up and don't go. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to maintain the facility. The control group is just people who either have a gym membership and don't work out or just don't do anything at all.
Yeah, absolutely.
So basically, you're talking about building a balance of some aerobic capacity, some muscle size through some hypertrophy style training, building connective tissue strength through, you know, the more, you know, higher rep type exercises, and then building strength, and then expressing that strength through power. Is that basically summing it up?
Perfect.
That was kind of the one thing I never understood at the beginning when Blakely and I were, you know, going through the certification process with starting strength, was like, why are power cleans and snatches involved in this strength program? And it's exactly for what you're talking about. It's an expression of the power. It's using power as the expression of the strength that you've been building during this time.
Absolutely.
And I can see, you know, just from our own personal experience, like, you know, we did CrossFit exclusively from about 2009, probably through about 2016 exclusively. That's not completely true, but I'll say during that time that we did exclusively CrossFit, we built up a lot of aerobic capacity and the ability, you know, a lot of muscular endurance just because of the high rep nature of it. But we really didn't get a whole lot stronger because we weren't following a progressive overload strength program. And you know, you're just not lifting that heavy of a weight to you know, that builds strength. You're not training your nervous system in that way, really. And then starting doing just the starting strength program and pulling back from CrossFit, started to get some of the injuries that are a little more common with just doing strength training, because, you know, we're talking about things like, you know, patellar tendonitis and, you know, elbow tendonitis and that kind of stuff. So, it really is about having a balance of all these things, that is building the well-rounded 50 and 60 year old athlete, I feel like.
Yeah. And it, you know, the other thing I would say is that variation is important, but systematic variation.
So true.
And I think that's the mistake that people make a lot is there's a lot of randomness in their program. And because of the randomness, you know, you never get accustomed to anything. Like you never have enough skill competency to work on strength because you're trying to figure out a new exercise every day. You know, that I would say that is one of the thing that irritates me the most about the field. I hear people say all the time, well, you know, I ask them, why do you have so much variation in your exercise? And they say, well, you know, my clients want to be entertained. And nothing makes me angrier than that comment, because, you know, if you want to be entertained, you know, go to the movies, you know, go to the comedy show, whatever, you know, if you want to get better, go to the weight room. And there's a need for us to hold constant some of the exercises and to systematically vary the volume and the intensity. And every 6 to 8 weeks, change those exercises over time. And that's really that's what programming is, but it's that systematic variation in building towards a goal, right? I think that's the other mistake that people make is, you know, why are you training, right? You've got to have some purpose, and that purpose has to drive your training. And that purpose might be, I want to run a 5K, or that purpose might be, I want to be able to catch my grandkids, you know, when they're running in the yard. And then we need to program and build towards that goal. And I think that's really, you know, what programming and periodization is all about when we're thinking about, you know, the person who's not a competitive athlete.
Yeah. I think a lot of people forget that so much of what we do in the weight room is is really practice. Like we literally get better at doing the movements, which makes us get more benefit out of it. So like you said, if we're changing up the exercise every week and not repeating it, by the time we get back around to doing it, we've kind of forgotten the movement pattern. You know, so much of this is driven by, you know, the nervous system adaptation to doing the movement. So if somebody's changing it all the time, forget about making progress. You're really just relearning how to do it constantly.
Yeah, exactly. You're learning a bunch of exercises and that's not the goal of training. You know, there's, in motor control, we say that strength is coordination and coordination is strength. You know, we gain strength just from becoming more coordinated in a movement, more competent in how to perform it, you know, irrespective of ever having any change in muscle size. And that's, an important concept to realize when you're training.
Yeah. I think we'd be doing everybody listening to this a disservice if we didn't at least spend a little bit of time talking about nutrition, because it's, you know, we talk about it all the time. It truly is the base of being able to do all the things that we've talked about up until this part of the episode. So, 75% of people in America are either overweight or obese. And I'd probably argue that almost 100% are under-muscled. I don't know if you'd agree with that statistic, but thinking about where we are at personally in our life and wanting to do what we can now to set ourselves up for success later, why does this matter, you know, at where we're at right now? Why can't we just worry about our nutrition later?
Yeah. So, you know, kind of the same concept, right? The choices that we make in our nutrition are setting the stage for where we are later in life with the reserve and thinking specifically about, as we get older, maintaining muscle mass, incredibly important. Muscle and kind of our understanding of it's important for health is kind of at the forefront right now. And very interestingly, as we get older, weighing more is actually protective for our health. So after the age of 60, people who are lighter tend to get sick and die more often than people that are heavier, that are carrying a little bit more weight, and especially if more of that weight is muscle. And you know, our nutritional, it you can't out exercise a bad diet. You know, I think that's, you know, this is coming from Bill Amonette, the exercise physiologist, saying that if you're making bad choices in your diet, there's nothing you can do to overcome that. Now you might mask it to a certain extent, but you're not going to be overcome that. And so nutrition is the base of everything, and we have to have discipline to make the right decisions there from the beginning.
I think one important thing you said there that maybe somebody who's driving and listening to this or listening to it on 1.5 times speed might have missed is you said that it's beneficial as you age to have more weight on you, especially if it's muscle. I don't want people to walk away from this being like saying like, oh, Bill said it's better for me to gain just to weigh more as I get older.
Yeah.
What your body composition is as you age is probably equally as important as just the what actual number on the scale. What when you start working with somebody and you look at their nutrition, what are some of the most common pitfalls that you see people fall into, misconceptions, those kinds of things?
I think, you know, the very first thing that we look at, especially with the population that we work with, is making sure that they're getting enough protein in their diet, and making sure that's good quality protein, and that protein is dispersed across the day appropriately. And you know, I think one of the misconceptions with protein is that, you know, protein is made up of amino acids. So when we lift weights, those amino acids are incorporated into muscle and it grows back stronger than it was before. And that's true to a certain extent. But what we know about protein now is that it's an incredibly important signaling molecule for anabolism or muscle growth. So when we consume protein, okay, there is a net increase in skeletal muscle protein synthesis through a pathway called mTOR. And you'll hear mTOR talked about all the time in the literature, mammalian target of rapamycin. It's a signaling pathway for anabolism in muscle. it's how exercise, the tension in exercise causes muscle growth. But when we just consume protein, okay, mTOR is activated and we have an increase in muscle protein synthesis. And so we saturate that signaling pathway, and it's debated in the literature, but it's probably somewhere between 30 and 40 grams in a meal. And anything more than that is not unhealthy for us, but it's not necessarily going to have a greater effect. And it takes 3 to 4 hours for that pathway to recover. And so when we're looking at a strategy to maintain muscle, it's getting that 30 to 40 grams of protein 4 times a day, and not having all that protein at the end of the day, right? You look at a lot of people's diet, and there's literature that supports this. They will eat, 90 grams of protein for dinner, and they had Frosted Flakes for breakfast and no protein, and then a sandwich with a little bit of ham and maybe 10 grams. And you look at their overall protein intake and you say, oh, well, they got enough for the day, right? They met the requirements, but they didn't really. They missed those opportunities to stimulate muscle growth. And by the way, I'm saying all that in the context of somebody who's healthy weight, right? Mm-hmm. I believe in fasting. I think there's a lot of evidence that supports intermittent fasting if there's weight control issues and stuff like that. But I'm talking about the healthy older adult who needs to eat protein to maintain their muscle mass, or the middle-aged individual who needs to maximize their eating so that they can go into their later years with more muscle mass.
Yeah, I like to think about what you're talking about, kind of like a teeter-totter. And, on one side of the scale, we have being in an anabolic state and the other side of the catabolic state work. Yeah. And we're trying to spend more time throughout the day in that anabolic state. And like you said, when you have toast and one egg for breakfast, a piece of fruit and another piece of toast for lunch, you're spending almost your entire day not in a building phase. And, one day, not a big deal, but that is your default over years, months. Yeah, it's going to add up over time.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And you made me think of another thing. An analogy I like to use with clients is, the total quantity of food that you eat throughout the day is kind of like the gas pedal of your weight. It controls whether you're going to be gaining or losing weight. And then the way you break those calories down across the three macronutrients is kind of like the steering wheel of how your body composition is going to change. Divert more of those calories over towards protein. You're going to be giving your body the signal that it needs to build.
Absolutely. That great analogy.
I think I probably stole it from somebody, so let's be honest. last question, and we could probably turn this into an episode in the future because it's super fascinating to me, but thinking about the work that you've done with the astronauts, thinking about work you did with professional athletes, and then just the Gen Pop people that you serve through the Institute. What are the common threads that people that are able to successfully implement all these things that we're talking about? What does it take to turn this from an idea into a practical application from a day-to-day basis and all these people that actually are doing it?
Yeah. So I think, first and foremost, it's discipline, personal discipline. And, the discipline to meal plan, the discipline to go to the weight room, even when you don't want to, the discipline to adhere to a program that's hard, to force yourself to do hard things every day. Right. And it all comes back to that discipline. Right. And it's, you don't do it because it's what you want to do every day. You do it because it's the right thing to do every day. And those people tend to be more successful. But another question that I think is, or another idea that's probably just as important is the why, right? We always tell people to try to think of the why, like, why are you here today? Who are you here for? Right. And at some point, it's probably I'm here for myself because I want to be healthy, but some people are motivated by I'm here because I want to be around for my grandkids as long as I can, or, you know, I want to be able to participate in this activity as long as I can, because it's important to me. And so when you have that context, you know, in your mind about my motivation for being here today, that makes the discipline be a little bit easier to swallow. Mm-hmm. And at least get you through that first period that we all know about, that first 3 or 4 weeks where we don't want to do it every day. And if we can just force ourselves to do it, we know eventually it's going to become a habit or become more regular, and the discipline is easier at that point. But to me, that is just the key. Like, there are people out there that they just do it even when they don't want to. And those are the ones that are most successful.
Yeah. And doing it when you don't want to can also provide you with some results, which serve as motivation. Also, I think people overlook that. It's like, you know, you will get the result that you're looking for if you just keep doing the work when you don't want to. And seeing that, whether it's your reflection in the mirror, you know, having more energy to do whatever you wanted to do, that's going to motivate you to keep going.
Yeah. You know, one thing that we always talk about in the Institute, and I communicate with the people that we work with, is we don't have outcome goals. We have process goals. And, you know, we'll do a test and they'll say, okay, well, what's my goal, right? What do you want my DEXA score to be next time? Or what do you want? How much do you want my balance to improve? And my answer is always, my goal for you is 4 days a week, right? 4 days a week, you get here 4 days a week and positive things are going to happen. I don't know how positive they're going to be, but I guarantee you that positive things are going to happen. And so you just make that commitment to the process goal, and you let the outcome be what it's going to be. And I think we know that if we commit and we're disciplined to the process of exercise, that there are going to be positive outcomes on the other end of it.
Yeah. I think anybody listening to this that has never tried that, do this exercise. Think about the outcome goal that you're so used to setting, and then stop and think, you know, actually take 5-10 minutes to think about this. What are the actions that are going to have to happen to lead to that outcome? And turn those actions into your daily goal. Forget about the outcome. And if you consistently do those processes that led, you know, that you said would lead to your outcome, you're going to get there. Absolutely. It's like, it's when we say, you know, I want to be able to squat 405, but then we don't actually take the time to lay out a process of a training program that might lead to that result, that we never get the goal. And then that loops back around and feeds into this psychological effect of feeling like we're a failure, because yet we set another goal that we didn't achieve because we didn't actually turn it into a process like you're talking about.
Yeah.
So we're on the same page as far as that goes. I'm not surprised.
Yeah.
Well, Bill, I really appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule to do this. If we do have a lot of clients and listeners in Houston, tell everybody what you're doing there at the Institute, because there might be people who want to take advantage of your services, and just anything that you want to leave our listeners with, and where they can get more information about what you guys are doing.
Yeah, so University of Houston, Clear Lake, down in the Clear Lake community, Health and Human Performance Institute. If you Google UHCL HHPI, you'll come to the landing page for the Institute. We have a number of programs for individuals who are older, a muscle matters program that focuses on gaining skeletal muscle mass and maintaining as we age, an osteoporosis program for people with low bone mass. We have a program, a resiliency program for people with cachectic diseases such as cancer. And kind of one of our newer initiatives, we have a traumatic brain injury program that we're offering here through the university, really low cost. We're trying to make a difference in our community, and we're doing that through dedicating our time and talent, and also conducting research. So everybody who's a part of our institute agrees or volunteers to be in research with us. And we, you know, along with making a difference in your life and the people that we work with, we want your story to be a part of the collective story of science, you know, that we hope will transform the way that we operate the bar barbell around the world.
We came full circle.
Yep.
Awesome, man. Well, I really appreciate this. Hope everybody listening to this enjoyed it and looks forward to the next time we get to have Bill on. Hopefully we get to do it in person next time. Blakely and I will head over to Houston and pop in for a visit.
Yep. So bring me a t-shirt when you come.
All right. Sounds good, man. All right. All right. Thanks again.
Thank you. Y'all have a good day.
Same to you.